The Lord be with you.
And also with
you. Welcome. It's always good to be in this chapel again, isn't it?
Yes.
Everybody can sit there and close their eyes and remember 50 years ago and pay no attention to whatever's going on up here. Sometimes that's a good thing.
Yeah.
Well, moving on, this Saturday is Rise Against Hunger down at the Lutheran building. So you'll have to go all the way down to the other block to Beth Eden and join us to pack little bags full of rice and beans and dehydrated stuff that people somewhere in the world can boil in water and make a meal. And it's extremely healthy and good. And we're going to try to do how many thousands of bags? I don't know, like 5,000 bags or something. It takes a couple hours. It's a fun process. So I hope you'll sign up and be there. If you can't figure out how to sign up, just show up at 1 o'clock, I think, or 1:30. There are signs everywhere in the building about it. But it's Saturday afternoon at Beth Eden. If you don't want to show up, but you can get online, then make a donation because we need some more money because we have to pay for the, that's how they work. So we pack these bags, we also pay for them. And so that way it's all taken care of. So that is next Saturday and I hope you'll join us. And I hope that you will stay awake and pay attention, and I hope that you'll have a good time today. Let us prepare ourselves then to worship God with the prelude.
Please stand in body or spirit and join together in the call to worship. I love the Lord because God has heard my voice and my supplications. Because you incline your ear to me, therefore I will call on you as long as I live. I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord.
I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all God's people.
Let us worship God. Join me in the prayer of praise and adoration. We enter your courts with praise, O God. We come into your house with thanksgiving. In Christ you give us the cup of salvation. In him we receive the bread of life. To you indeed our vows are to be made. You shall hear our confession of faith. So be with us now as we gather, and be pleased with the homage we bring.
Thank you.
Join me in the litany of affirmation. You know that you were ransomed from futile ways with the precious blood of Christ. That word is the good news preached to us. He was destined before the foundation of the world, but was made manifest at the end of all times for your sake. That word is good news preached to us. Through him you have confidence in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory. That word is the good news preached to us. Having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth, love one another earnestly from the heart. That word is the good news preached to us. You have been born anew through the living and abiding word of God. That word is the good news preached to us. Gracious God, we do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from your mouth. Make us hungry for this heavenly food, that it may nourish us today in the ways of eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, the bread of heaven. Amen. Our first lesson comes with from Acts 2, verses 14 and 36 through 41. But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them. Therefore, let the entire house of Israel know with certainty that God has made him both Lord and Messiah, this Jesus whom you crucified. Now, when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the other disciples, "Brothers, what should we do?" Peter said to them, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, so that your sins may be forgiven, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you, for your children, and for all who are far away, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to him." And he testified with many other arguments and exhorted them, saying, "Save yourselves from this corrupt generation." So those who welcomed his message were baptized, and that day about 3,000 persons were added. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. morning. I'd like to invite all the children and youth to come forward for time for young disciples. Good morning, baby. All right, so our lesson today comes from the Gospel of Luke, and it's about two disciples who were leaving Jerusalem and walking down the road together, and they were talking about the events that had just happened, the events that Jesus was arrested, and he was tried, and he was put on a cross, and then he died and was buried, right? And they had even heard from the women who had been at the tomb that Jesus had arose from the grave. He wasn't dead anymore, but they were like, there's no way. And last week we talked about Thomas, right? And Thomas doubted, and he said, I'm not going to believe until I see the wounds on his hands and his side, right? So these two disciples were walking, and they were talking about everything that had happened, and, you know, they thought that Jesus was going to come and take over the city and rule and be the ruler and the king there. But Jesus came to save in a different way, right? Yeah, to save us from our sins. Then all of a sudden, the two disciples notice that there's somebody walking with them. Now, it's actually Jesus, but for whatever reason, the two disciples don't recognize Jesus. They don't see that it's Jesus. Now, people wonder why this is, and maybe it was because maybe they were doubting, too, that there's no way he could be alive, right? Or maybe they were just sad and just so upset because they thought Jesus was going to be the one that was going to come, like I said, and take over the city and save them all. But then after a while, they had walked a different way, and then Jesus kept going. He said, and the disciples said, no, come with us. Come, you know, come have something to eat with us. And when Jesus broke the bread, they recognized him, and then he disappeared. Now, there may be some times in your life where you're like these disciples, and you're walking, and you may be sad or upset, or something has happened in your life, and you're like, God, Jesus, where are you? Right? But the thing is that even though we can't see him, or maybe we don't recognize what he's doing in our lives, he's still there with us all the time. No matter what's going on in your life, he is always there, no matter what road you're going down in life, right? Because sometimes you might make the wrong turn and go down a road you're not supposed to. But that's okay, because Jesus is always with you, right? Yes? Awesome. All right. So, if you are going to blast, you're going to go with Miss Robin. She's right there, and you'll go down with her. But before we do that, let's say a prayer together, okay? Ready? Repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for always being with us, no matter what road we walk down. Amen.
So the reading comes from Luke chapter 24, verses 13 through 35. That same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. And while they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. He said to them, "What are you talking about? What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" And they stood still, looking sad. And then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place in these days?" And he asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it's now the third day since these things took place. And moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. And some of those who were there with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" And then beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near to the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us. It's almost evening and the day is nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. And when he was at table with him, he took bread and blessed and broke it and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road and while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord is risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." And then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of bread. This is the word of the Lord. This is kind of a play in three acts, you know. And the first act is on the road, and these two disciples are just walking along dejected. I mean, the one that they loved, the one who mattered, the one on whom they pinned their hopes, he's dead. He's been executed. There's nothing they can do. There's nothing for them now. So they head out for Emmaus. Yeah, there's some talk about him being raised from the dead and the tomb being empty, but no one knows for sure, and it's hard to check. I mean, the Romans are keeping a watch on that tomb. And then a man comes along and joins them, and they say, he says, "Why are you so sad?" And they say, "Are you the only person in all of Jerusalem who doesn't know what's going on?" And they tell him, and they tell him all about Jesus, and they tell him that the tomb is reported to be empty. And he says, "Wasn't this all necessary for the Messiah to suffer and then enter into his glory?" And then he begins with Moses and the law and all the prophets, and he interprets everything about him in the scriptures. And they're looking at him going, you know, who is this guy? What did he tell them? He might have mentioned Genesis 3:15. How God told the snake in the Garden of Eden that the woman's offspring would crush his head, and when the snake struck his heel, that was a prophecy of the Messiah, who won't simply kill a snake, but who will kill the snake, that ancient enemy and tempter. Jesus overcomes evil and crushes the power of the serpent on the cross. Speaking of snakes, there's Numbers chapter 21 he could have mentioned, where the story about the people being attacked in the desert wilderness by poisonous snakes, and they're dying. There's snakes everywhere. They can't get away from the snakes. And Moses is told, put one on a pole and raise it up. And if they look at it, they'll be healed and kept safe. This is also taken as a prophecy. Jesus is raised up on a pole on the cross. Those who look to him for salvation will be saved. Gregory of Nyssa, who's an ancient theologian, describes this as a mystery and says, Jesus suffers for us, and whoever turns to the cross and looked at it is not harmed by the poison of desire. To look to the cross means to render one's whole life dead and crucified to the world, unmoved by evil. So desire for Nyssa are like serpents that attack us. And the only answer when you're attacked is to look to Jesus, to look to the cross, and be reminded again and again of his love for us. Well, just before that story, also in Numbers, you know, Numbers is a book no one ever reads, right? But we read that the people grumble and complain to Moses that they're hungry, they're starving. Why did you bring us out here in the desert? We wish we were back in Egypt. There was plenty of food in Egypt. And Moses gets mad, I think, and takes his staff and smashes it on a rock. The rock splits open and water pours out. And the people have something to drink. And then manna comes from heaven and they have something to eat. And they say, well, God does provide, doesn't he? Provides water from the rock. Provides the living water from the rock of our salvation, Jesus Christ. And then there's the Passover story itself. The people are told to eat a lamb, but fix it a certain way. And then they're to paint the doorways of their house with the blood from the lamb. And during the night, the angel of death passes over the houses that have blood on the posts. So the Hebrews are spared having their firstborn die. They're saved by the blood of the lamb, literally. And many years later on Passover, they're saved as we are by one whose blood was shed on the cross. So all these stories, these different stories have something in common. The cross. It was necessary for the Messiah to suffer. Well, there are many more places that tell about Jesus and the prophets. Too many for me to list. Some of you are happy about that. But if you look at Psalm 22, you find a lament and a prayer from deliverance from a terrible illness. But it's also a virtual description of the crucifixion. It begins, my God, why have you forsaken me? And moves through lines like, my mouth is dried up like a piece of pottery. And they stare and gloat over me. They divide my clothing and they throw dice for it. Well, all of that happened when Jesus died. The scriptures predict what will happen, and he manages to fulfill it. The Messiah had to suffer. Psalm 118, the stone that the builders rejected became the chief cornerstone. Who's the stone rejected by the builders? It's Jesus. He suffered and died, rejected by those who knew him. Or Psalm 69, zeal for your house has consumed me. Jesus quotes that one when he turns over the tables of the money changers. Those who oppose God also oppose Jesus. Then there's Isaiah 52 and 53, that long passage that we read every year on Maundy Thursday. It describes the death of Jesus in familiar terms. He was despised, rejected by others, a man of suffering, acquainted with grief. As from one As one from whom others hide their faces, he was despised. And he suffered and died, wounded for our transgressions. And they made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich. It resonates in every phrase with images of his suffering and his crucifixion and his death. And so the point is that Jesus suffers by necessity. He didn't just happen to get in the way of the Romans. He didn't just happen to get in the way of the Jewish leaders and hunk them off and get crucified for his trouble. He had to die. And he had to do this in order to save us. That's what he told the disciples on the road to Emmaus. And so everything in the Bible and what we call the Old Testament, it all points to Jesus and his cross and his suffering. Some parts are more clear than others. And the overriding tendency in all of it is to predict and foreshadow and prefigure and otherwise somehow show that Jesus is the fulfillment of God's plan. The Messiah had to suffer. So Act 2 happens at the dinner. They get to Emmaus. It's 7 miles from Jerusalem. That's a long walk. They arrive. It's evening, and they say to the stranger, "It's too late to keep walking. Come on, have supper with us." And he says, "All right." And at supper, he blesses the bread and breaks it just like he did at that other supper a few days before. And they recognize him. This is Jesus. The risen Lord's been with them all day. And before they can say a word, he vanishes. But there's something in the way he broke the bread and passed it. There's something about the way he spoke. They recognize that this man is Jesus. Now, some say they didn't recognize him because they didn't expect him. Or they didn't yet understand that he had to suffer. I think he deliberately somehow hid his identity from them so that they would listen. But now they recognize he is Jesus, and he vanishes. You know, when we do communion, it's usually sad. It's a somber thing. We sing, "Jesus, remember me." And we think thoughts about the Last Supper. We pray for forgiveness. It's all sad. But the early church had liturgies for communion that were not sad. It was not the Last Supper every time they had the liturgy. No. Sometimes it was a joyful celebration of resurrection. He's raised and he's coming back, and we will all be together in God's presence forever. Now, in the church I served up in Martinsville, we had an organist. She was, you know, capable, but just barely. She wasn't all that great. You know, let's be honest. When it came time for communion, she'd pick a hymn that she liked, and she'd play it over and over and over, 3 or 4 times, or 25 times. And one that she liked to play in the summertime was "Let Us Talents and Tongues Employ." And she played it on the flute pipes, you know, do, 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 do. And the people called it Happy Communion. And they would come up to me and say, "Are we having the birthday song today?" You know, and when we did, they'd be joyful. I mean, communion represents the meals that Jesus ate with his disciples, especially that last one. And we're told that the bread represents his body and the wine his blood, broken and poured out for us and our salvation. We are literally fed by his body and blood. And you could understand that any way you want to. But I will remind you of the words of the great Flannery O'Connor, who said, "If it's just a symbol, then to heck with it. Jesus feeds us and gives us life somehow." So they recognize him in the breaking of the bread. It's that broken bread that connects us to him. We recognize who he is as we break the bread. We recognize that he's one of us. We recognize that he suffers for us and with us. And we see the salvation that he gives us is not to be taken lightly. In his dying, we find new life. So then Act 3. They run all the way back to Jerusalem. It's taken them all day to walk 7 miles, but they run back in like half an hour, you know, running. He's alive. And they bring this news to the disciples, and the disciples are like, we already know he's alive. So this is not just some stranger on the road who happens to be really good at interpreting the Old Testament. This is not just, you know, some amateur theologian who knows his Hebrew Bible inside out or some perceptive outsider. This is Jesus himself. And he explains it all to them. And then they have supper. And it's so much more than just a meal. He's revealed as Jesus, and the supper is revealed as the way that he communicates himself to us. And the reformers said, well, you should always have preaching before you have communion. And by that, they meant like 5 hours of preaching, but you should always have preaching, and we agree. So, let's get up and run back to Jerusalem. Let's go back to those who will hear us. Let's tell people who will hear us, our friends and neighbors, that the Lord is risen. There's so much more for us to see and understand and experience and learn. There's forgiveness and there's healing and there's life. Alleluia. Amen.
Join me in the affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. So as we come to pray, keep in prayers, please, Cranford family. Melanie died Tuesday night, and the funeral was Friday. Scott and his sister and her family left this morning for Pawleys Island for a week off to take a break. But Lee, who broke her shoulder a few weeks ago, or her wrist, so many broken shoulders in this church. She broke her wrist. She is back in her house. So if you're looking for somebody to visit, she'd be a good one. And Doug Michaels' Aunt Pixie, that's been coming to worship sometimes, you may remember, she had a heart attack and was in the hospital for several days, but she is home now as well. So let's pray for them and for the others. Let's pray. Life is filled with trouble, O Lord. Things attack us like snakes, nipping at our heels and trying to bite us, coming out of the darkness, underneath things. We never know when something is going to try to get us, to tempt us. We never know. But we know that we can look up at the one risen on the pole, the one hanging there, Jesus Christ. We look at him for our salvation. We look at him and we find life. So amid the snakes that would try to kill us, we get life and we give you thanks and praise. We do pray for Scott Cranford and his family, for Melanie's family, for all of them. We pray that you will give them rest this week and help them to cope with and adjust to this new reality that she is gone. But we hope indeed that you will help them to cherish her memories and not lose heart. We pray for Pixie and for all the others on our prayer list that you will give them healing and comfort, that you will make your presence and care known to them this very day. Let them know that your spirit is with them. Let them know and feel your presence. And we don't even understand what those words mean, Lord. But we know that you are real, for we have felt your presence. We give you thanks that we can worship you together in a land that's free. We pray for those who govern us. We pray for those who fight to defend our freedoms. We pray that you will bring peace to this world, the whole world round. Because everybody just wants to live and breathe and eat and be left alone. Nobody wants fighting and warfare. And so we pray for peace, O God. We pray for your church in all of its many and weird forms, in all of the places that people gather and worship you, however they worship. We pray that their worship would be genuine. We pray that their experience of the Spirit would be real. We pray that they would know that the risen Lord is alive and is real. We have our own prayers, O God, the things that frustrate us and disappoint us and the things that we'd hope for that won't come true. But we pray that you will help us to see, help us to know that Jesus is alive. And so that no matter what happens to us, we have that message to proclaim and that message to cling to. We know that you hear our prayers in his name. And we ask that you hear us as we pray that prayer that he taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now let us worship God with our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
And let us pray together. We bring our gifts to you in response to good news. Christ is risen indeed and abides in us still. May all that we do be in response to new life. As you accept who we are, O God, receive what we offer, and transform all our being to conform to your will. Extend your grace through us so that others hear of the salvation you bring. Amen. So go in peace. Go and rejoice, for the Lord is risen. And as you go, may all the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit go with you today and every day forever. Alleluia.